Welcome to Electrified with your host, Dylan Loomis. The Tesla cylindrical battery has often been met with confusion and skepticism as of late due to the emergence of pouch and prismatic style batteries in recent years. Outside of Tesla and Rivian, all of the main auto players pursuing EVs are seemingly choosing pouch or prismatic battery cells. It's crucial to keep the two main aspects of this decision in mind. First, corporations must look at the production and development factors on the individual cell level. The costs, production capabilities, chemistry optimization, etc. for producing one cell, which has been the primary use case for consumer electronics such as cell phones and laptops. The huge consideration is the packaging of these individual cells into modules and packs. Pairing hundreds of pouch or prismatic cells or thousands of cylindrical cells into modules and packs requires an incredibly complex manufacturing prowess to ensure the energy storage system, or ESS, as a whole performs at an elite level while also being safe and cost-effective. These battery management systems, BMS, or thermal management systems, TMS, have not been required at scale until the advent of the electric vehicle. These systems allow consumers and manufacturers to know the state of charge and state of capacity at any given time. They prompt caution and service needs by monitoring high temperatures and cell imbalances, and they also indicate end of life when capacity falls below certain thresholds. The most basic functions of thermal management systems are battery protection and state of charge readings, but even those require sophisticated software systems. Thus, choosing a form factor based on an analysis of single-cell data is a fool's errand when ultimately considering a use case for an electric vehicle. To start, here are images of the three main lithium-ion cell formats, cylindrical, pouch, and prismatic. Covering the high-level differences will be the best way to start, and with this understanding, we'll move into deciphering why Tesla has chosen the cylindrical battery route, which continues to be one of the most widely used packaging styles due to ease of manufacture and good mechanical stability due to the tubular cylinder, which can withstand high internal pressures without deforming. Cylindrical cells have a positive thermal coefficient, or PTC, switch that serves as short circuit protection when exposed to excessive currents. Most also include a charge interrupt device, or CID, that physically and irreversibly disconnect the cell when unsafe pressure levels build in the cell. Tesla has always been primarily driven by safety in tandem with a sustainable future, an aspect that is commonly overlooked by consumers when considering a Tesla purchase. The cylindrical battery design has good cycling ability and can provide long lifespans. Some of the often discussed drawbacks of this form factor are added weight and low packaging density due to space cavities when combined into modules and packs. Cylindrical cells do not fully utilize the space when packaged together. Empty space can be used for cooling to improve thermal management if done correctly, as spacing can actually help with thermal issues. Cylindrical cells don't change in size, while pouch and prismatic cells can and do. This cell type also lends itself well to automated manufacturing. Pouch cells use conductive foil tabs welded to electrodes using a design that offers a simple, flexible, and lightweight solution. Pouch cells can deliver high load currents, but they have typically performed best under light loading conditions and with moderate charging, although the performance of pouch and prismatic cells have improved quickly over the last 10 years. Pouch cells make the best use of space by achieving 90 to 95% packaging efficiency, which is the highest among the three types. Eliminating the metal enclosure reduces weight, and the flexible pouch allows cells to be stacked easily. Pouch cells can have the potential for greater capacity than the cylindrical format, as large, quote, flat packs, as they've been called, have been used with good results on the cell level. Flat cell designs have come down dramatically in cost over the last 10 years, and when looking at the individual cell level, they've achieved close to cost parity with cylindrical cells. This, of course, changes at scale due to manufacturing quantities, and Tesla has single-handedly driven down the cylindrical costs when considering production rates. But when considering bare cell costs only, the three types are very close as of today. With pouch cells, some stacking pressure is recommended, but there must be allowance for swelling. Smaller pouch packs can grow 5 to 10% in size over just 500 cycles. This increases the importance of handling any sharp edges as they expand. Due to this, pouch cells are often made by adding a temporary gas bag on the side. Gases escape into this bag during the first charge, and then the gas bag is cut off and the pouch is resealed as part of the finishing process. Subsequent charges in an electric vehicle will produce minimal gases, but swelling cannot be fully avoided. Due to the laminated bag architecture, exposure to humidity and high temperature can shorten lifespans.
So, quick update. As I was exporting this video, we got some news about Tesla, CATL, and how they might be using prismatic battery cells for their Made in China Model 3 Standard Range Plus model. It would be a lithium iron phosphate battery. And there's so many implications and things that we can dive into, but for now, just know that there's a seemingly good chance that Tesla will be using prismatic cells for the first time. You're gonna hear a little bit about prismatic cells in this video momentarily, so just keep that in the back of your mind, and then I'm sure with future videos as this unfolds more, you know, we'll cover it in depth, but yeah, super surprising, crazy news. I'll link up with you back at the end of the video.
The prismatic cell satisfies the demand for thinner sizes and can make optimal use of a space by using a layered approach. Prismatic cells can be available in large formats and are packaged and welded in aluminum housings. The prismatic cell can be more expensive to manufacture while being less efficient in thermal management with shorter life cycles than the cylindrical design. Manufacturers must also allow for some swelling with this form factor. Due to this swelling with prismatic cells, some mechanical pressure should be applied to keep their shape. Prismatic cells suffer less from swelling than pouch cells, but do not perform as well in this regard as cylindrical cells. Panasonic and Toyota recently announced a joint venture called Prime Planet Energy Solutions that will begin operations in April of this year to work on the development and production of prismatic lithium-ion batteries for EVs, while also working on solid-state batteries. We'll be sure to monitor this. Prime Planet Solutions is 51% owned by Toyota and 49% by Panasonic. As you can deduce from the high-level overview, this really is a game of trade-offs. As of today, there are clear pros and cons of each form factor, and there is not one clear winner. While Tesla uses cylindrical cells and has clear range and performance advantages over the competition, to then say that cylindrical cells are the best choice is a lazy and inaccurate analysis. As noted, module and pack construction paired with thermal management systems make up a huge part of the ultimate performance metrics and are approached differently by each company. The intelligence of the battery does not only lie in the cell, but in the complex battery system. An argument can also be made that other auto manufacturers know they can't catch Tesla using cylindrical cells as they have a 15-year head start maximizing efficiencies with this cell style, so they're looking for competitive advantages using pouch or prismatic form factors. Bear in mind, this is something they could never admit to publicly. There are, of course, other reasons, as mentioned, as these form factors have dramatically improved in recent years. Let's now piece everything together as to why Tesla chose cylindrical cells back in the early 2000s when they started to work on the original Roadster. Tesla released a paper back in 2006 about this choice. Let's take a look at what they shared publicly. From the paper, cells within the pack need to be protected from adverse situations that could be electrical, mechanical, or thermal in nature. We started our design by purposely picking a small form factor battery cell called the 18650. Due to the small size, the cell contains limited energy, so if there's a failure in the cell, the effect will be much less than that expected from larger cells. Billions of 18650s are made each year, and engineers at Tesla selected cells from reputable Fortune 500 suppliers that have produced billions of safe and reliable lithium-ion batteries. The method by which the cells are electrically connected can have a huge impact on the overall pack safety. The cooling system is effective due to combining thousands of small cells to build an ESS, increasing the surface-to-volume ratio, which is essential for cooling batteries, since the surface is where heat is removed, and thus, more surface area is better. Also, due to their small size, each cell is able to quickly redistribute heat from within, making it isothermal. This paper is linked below. Pair this with the timeline of the creation of these cell form factors. The cylindrical cell has been around since the mid-50s, while the prismatic cell wasn't created until the 1980s, and the pouch cell in the mid-90s. In the early 2000s, when Tesla was making a decision, cylindrical cells were the most reliable, most commonly produced, and very clearly the cheapest option. Thus, for the better part of 15 years, Tesla has been laser-focused on increasing every aspect of this system using the cylindrical form factor. This is why they have the best performance metrics by a long shot. They have the best cell chemistry, the most automated production methods, the most advanced battery management software, all designed specifically for use with a cylindrical cell style. When they switched from the 18650 cell to the 2170 cells for Model 3 production, they could have at that point chosen a pouch or prismatic form factor before committing to that design choice, but they're very clearly committed to being the world leader by using cylindrical cells. Other automakers do not have the experience, manufacturing capability, or software that Tesla has using cylindrical cells, so they could very well be better served to look for competitive advantages elsewhere. If the slate were wiped clean and everyone was starting from scratch, there could be a solid case made for choosing any of the three cell formats the way things stand today. From a long-term point of view, we're still in the infancy stages of the development stages for pouch and prismatic battery cell form factors. I hope that you'll understand from this video that as of today, there is not a clear and simple best cell format for any one manufacturer. There are simply too many variables at play, and oversimplification in this space is harmful. As stated, solid arguments can be made for each. Tesla's battery lead is never going to be pinned solely on their use of cylindrical cells, just like the Porsche Taycan's disappointing initial performance metrics cannot solely be pinned on their use of pouch cells. A lot can change over the next 10 years, and we should all be rooting for automakers to find a way to make pouch and prismatic battery cells competitive with what Tesla is doing with cylindrical cells. It will further increase competition and drive down costs, which is going to be pivotal for increased EV adoption and awareness, which will also further drive down costs as adoption rates increase. A win for everyone involved. Perhaps a clear form factor battery cell will emerge over the next 10 to 20 years, but there's just as good of a chance that all three remain viable options in tandem with the various approaches manufacturers will take with battery management systems and all of the other variables at play.
All right, so if you're still watching this video, thank you. I know these last few have been longer, but honestly, this information is crucial to the future of Tesla, whether you're a fan or an investor. So good for you if you're consuming all this content and really trying to learn it and take it in. Couple of quick community updates. So the giveaway, we've decided we're gonna get to our 50 entrant number by the next video next week, and then we're gonna do the drawing the following week. So keep commenting on this video and the next one, and you'll have a chance to be chosen to be on the list. And new free ways to support the channel: if you see the ads when you're watching the video, if you just let the ad play through, that's honestly a huge help. I know they're annoying and frustrating. I've been a consumer of YouTube content for a long time, and that was part of why I bought YouTube Premium, so I don't have to watch ads. But That's one way. And then if you shop on Amazon at all, if you just click my link in the description and then go buy whatever you're gonna buy, whether it's Kleenex or whatever, that actually does really help me too. So just keep that in mind if you wanna support the research and time that I'm putting into these videos. But as you guys know, just watching, liking, commenting, subscribing, all the good things, it really helps. I'm super grateful. I love being able to talk about Tesla and interact with you guys. And definitely a lot planned for the future that I'm super excited about. It just feels like right now it makes the most sense to be making these research heavy videos, talking about the battery world with everything that'll be coming up in April. So as always, guys, thank you for watching. And yeah, pumped for the next video. Hope you guys have an awesome, awesome weekend.